Welcome to Solutions by Dave, and we're doing a beta presentation of Panda Implication, Panda Solution, a product of solutionsbydave.com. So when we look at typical site ranking considerations according to most SEOs, most of us look at basic algorithm functions. We look at negative filtering actions. We look at positive ranking signals, competitive environment, and then considerations of branding and local, seven pack, things like that. And so that's always been the basics of SEO. Now we get into a situation, especially in the last couple of years, where there's been a lot of shift and a lot of blame placed on a lot of things. But Google does like to move stuff around, and we've seen everything get moved in the last couple of years. And they don't really care where you show up in search results. They care about how their search results are presented to their web visitors in a way that they come back to Google next time to get more information, and then they are able to sell their advertising to those visitors. Google's primary filtering mechanisms, according to 99% of all SEOs, and there's truth to all of this, is the Panda algorithm, the Penguin algorithm, which hits you on commercial intent anchor text on low-quality websites, the Hummingbird algorithm, which is a kind of a translation algorithm, and over-optimization filtering. But let's take a look at what has traditionally been viewed as a negative algorithm. And here we go, and I'm going to read this, and it may sound painful to go through this entire abstract, but here's the implication of Panda, is that Google did file the Panda algorithm with the U.S. Patent Office. And when you file an invention, you can say whatever you like about it in the marketplace, but when you file a patent for it, you'd better be telling the truth, and you'd better be telling the whole truth about your patent. Because if you fail to make it clear what your invention is, someone else can come present the same invention with clear language to the patent office, and they will be the patent holder of what is described. So you have to tell the truth to the patent office. It's probably more difficult to lie to the patent office than it is to a judge or a court. So here we're going to read through this as quickly as possible. The patent is US 868289 2B1, titled Ranking Search Results. And here is the abstract. Methods, systems, and apparatus, including computer programs encoded on computer storage media. That's a fancy way of saying computers. For ranking search results. So here we have twice now, ranking search results. One of the methods includes, and before I proceed further, let's look at this very closely. This is an algorithm, a method, a patent for ranking search results, not for penalizing websites, not for judging the quality score of a website. It may do that, but the purpose is ranking search results. One of the methods includes determining for each of a plurality of groups of resources, that's an important phrase, a respective count of independent incoming links to resources in the group, determining for each of the plurality of groups of resources, again, a respective count of reference queries, that's people asking questions about the resource, determining for each of the plurality of groups of resources a respective group-specific modification factor. Now, there is your penalty aspect of the algorithm, that it can apply a modification factor to a group that is specific to that group, wherein the group-specific modification factor for each group is based on the count of independent links and the count of reference queries for the group and associating with each of the plurality of groups of resources, the respective group-specific modification factor for the group. wherein the respective group-specific modification for the group modifies initial scores generated for resources in the group in response to received search queries. Now, that may have been very painful, and now your ears may be bleeding, and your brain may be recoiling at that obviously recursive language, but it's very important, and we'll touch on it again in a little bit. But let's ask one question about this Panda abstract. Is there a mention of a single website in this abstract? No, there is no website. There, the closest it comes is groups of resources. And more often, it's plurality of groups of resources. So this is very not website oriented. This is group oriented. And I will suggest that what we have done here is created a distinction. If it were a political system, we'd be just creating a distinction between a rogue state like Korea and a member state like Germany. Germany's a member of the G7, the G22, a member of NATO, a member of the European Union, a member of all kinds of associations and member state entities, United Nations, you know, memberships, all kinds to validate the nation as a member state, whereas Korea is a member of North Korea, that is a member of North Korea, and they're a rogue state. All right. Here is the modification factor, the penalty portion that everyone is so concerned about, starting out with a question, is the query navigational to the resource? Which means, is somebody typing in Apple because they want apple.com? Are they typing in Amazon because they're looking for Amazon? Are they typing in Solutions by Dave because they know that is a brand name? If the answer is yes, modification to not modify the initial score is what's used. If the answer is no, you start to move toward modification factors so that you modify the query according to the group of resources. So there are specific modifications depending on the topic that the query is about. And that's all I'll delve into with that. So yes, there is modification of the query, that if you fall into a heavy modification score, you're likely less likely to be found in early search results. Let's look at old school SEO. This is what people did for SEO. They got a website and they went out and they got links to the website, even PBN links. And all the links point to your website. Now, the question that is begged here with the Panda algorithm is this what is naturally going to occur if something becomes popular and starts to be mentioned between people on websites? Of course, the answer is no. In the real world, website A may find a resource on website B, and then website A will write about it. And then website C may see website A and say, hey, here's something cool, and what link to website A, which is not the original source of the resource. But they saw it there, so they, here's where I read this, website A. Now, that in turn will have some influence on the membership of website B being mentioned as a source of the content. But this thing of linking in a concentric circle is very easy to detect because it's not a natural pattern. So the more that you have, the more Google starts to push back. And passing page rank does have influence, and this does work in the absence of anything better. And so old school SEO would take that concept and then they would try to obfuscate the pattern by creating a much bigger link wheel. But even in these sophisticated kinds of link wheels, you'd still have everything tending to cascade into a center target. And you'll see there's really no links between these things. There's just links driving inward to the center. Still old school. A bigger construct of websites, but old school. And now they start to get a little more sophisticated, but it's still easy for Google to see that everything points inward to the money site. Now, what's being successful is something more like link chaos. And I think this particular diagram may or may not have come from Network Empire. I'm not exactly sure, but you've got a little linking going on between sites from site to site, not necessarily just into the money site. The perfect world that Panda is looking at is more like this, that you've got one resource that connects to another, that connects to another, natural links occurring between resources, and then this in plurality. Now again, pardon me, we've got the propaganda versus the truth, and I pointed out that the Panda abstract for their filing of the patent with the U.S. Patent Office says one thing that's not very similar to what usually is talked about with Panda. Usually from Matt Cutts and John Mueller and the folks at Google all the way down, people talk about Panda in terms of penalties, layout, ad ratio, thin content, duplicate content, over-optimization, under-optimization, be careful, or Panda is going to penalize your site. And then segueing off of that, Google tells you, please create awesome content, create lots of awesome content, and wait for people to link to you. Okay. And the implication that Google has publicly given to people is that Panda is there to hurt you. Panda will find out what you're doing. Whatever you do wrong, Panda will find you and penalize you. And the truth is that, you know, guys at Google, people at Moz, and all these organizations that tell you what white hat SEO is, they may be saying white hat SEO, but even the white hat SEOs may not be telling you what is exactly good for you. So I want to focus on what we have seen from the abstract on the patent, what the true core Panda focus is, and I did leave a word off of my notes here, but it's associations, authority, groups, and trust. That's its true focus, and you just saw that in the abstract. The ideas that have been promoted about positive signals are PageRank, which will no longer be updated by Google. Author rank, author authority, of course, there's domain authority, page authority, and trust flow. And while those last three are closely associated with what's happening, they are an external measurement. And we're looking at what Google itself has said in its patent about Panda, and that is associations, authority, groups, and trust. So here is the Panda concept again, ranking search results, and I've highlighted the important parts of the language. And you see that plurality of groups of resources is mentioned four times in this little extract. Independent links is mentioned twice. Reference queries is mentioned twice. Group specific modification factor is mentioned three times. So those are important parts of the language. And they are to be paid attention to because this is describing for us exactly what Google is looking for to rank search results. And while it is one of the methods, I believe and evidence shows that this is Google's preferred method to rank resources, to rank websites, to rank pages. This is what they look for. Top priority, if you have a plurality of groups of resources and they align closely with what Google expects to be in the reference queries and links point to those resources within the groups, that's valid and that will rank ahead of things that simply have some page rank passed to them. So here we have a contrast between old school on the right and what Panda is looking for on the left. In the Panda universe, there's a group of green guys who will probably tend to link to things in the group of orange guys and the light green and the red and the dark blue, but not necessarily the yellow or purple or light blue. But people in the light group light blue group will link to the light green, they'll link to the orange, they'll link to the purple. So you have tendencies among these groups of resources to link to at least some of the other groups, establishing this neural network. It's very dynamic, it's very random, it's very chaotic, but it is fitting within the groups, the plurality of groups of resources. So if you do link to a target site, it becomes less evident exactly what the target site is, because the target site is just a member of one of the groups. So you create a network in which your target website is a member state with lots of other member states, and not a rogue state like you see on the right, where all things point to the one entity, but there's nothing within other groups that support that idea. So let's look at what a single group of resources might look like. And this particular presentation is pointed toward real estate in particular, because that's my niche. All right, so here we've got some common content curation websites. Scoop.it, Storify, Rebel Mouse, YouTube, of course, is a kind of a general purpose. And ActiveRain, that AR on the right, is a well-known real estate blogging and social network website, now owned by Trulia. And so now ActiveRain is a subdomain of Trulia. Guess what that means? That they are now picking up Trulia's domain authority, which is in the 90s. So you have these websites that have high authority. They have high domain authority. They're well respected and recognized as bona fide resources that are known by Google. So now we've got this group of resources, and higher authority resources have the most push and least likely to be considered spam. And there is an article I need to put in here, so maybe the next time I'll get that article that denotes how the arrangement of resources are looked at in terms of their likelihood to have spam or not have spam. And so we arrange the group this way. And you'll notice that, let's say our primary content is on what I'm calling the agent page, the real estate website with a particular page. And so I'm going to create content relevant to what's on that page in the ActiveRain blog post over here. And then once I have my ActiveRain content and linking to the agent page, I'll open up a Rebel Mouse and curate a paragraph and a lead-in original sentence on Rebel Mouse to the ActiveRain post. And here's content on ActiveRain, and I will also point to my agent page from Rebel Mouse. Same thing with Storify. I'll point to Rebel Mouse. Maybe I'll also point to the ActiveRain post. Maybe I will or won't point to the agent page. Probably in most cases I will. And same thing with Scoop.it, linking over to Storify. And then maybe I'll cap that off with YouTube and also include one of my PBNs into this mix, making it a member of this group of resources. Once those are constructed, I'll go to high authority sites like Facebook and take various posts in Facebook and point them to the mid-level resources in this group, okay? Now, that's one group. That's one group of resources. And if I do this, Google sees not a plurality of groups of resources. They just see a group. Okay? What Panda looks for is a plurality of groups of resources. Now, in this case, I have taken the original group on the left, and I've made another one that's similar but not the same. You'll see that in this case, I've got some unnamed sites in the middle. I've got a Pinterest site or page. I've got Twitter. I have LinkedIn and Facebook. And then on the right, I have another group of resources that stop at my PBN. And maybe that PBN links to one of these other targets of the other groups. But here I've got a plurality that includes two YouTube, Facebook, Pinterest, three YouTubes, an ActiveRain, and three other websites, and a PBN. Okay, so what I've done is I create these small clusters or groups, and each of them are somewhat random, and each of them point to a different page on the website, so that I'm creating plurality and not singularity. I'm avoiding the wheel that points in like spokes in a bicycle wheel and creating the natural plurality of groups. Okay, again, we look at the Panda algorithm, and it is looking for that plurality of groups of resources and count of independent incoming links, not to the website in the group, that's the target, but to resources in the group. So again, I'm going to back up a few steps here. We've got a website that's a member of the group. It's not the target of the group, it's a member of the group. And it's a member of a plurality of groups of resources, and it shares in the links between these members of groups in this plurality. So it's not the target site like you see on the right. Now, it may actually be our target, but it's not constructed in this group to look like the target. It's simply a member of a valid group of resources, and then we do that in plurality. And that's how we end up with this natural neural network in plural that Panda's looking for. Now that concludes the formal presentation of this. And if you have questions, this is a good time to open up discussion. Everybody should be able to turn their mic on. And I'm going to unmute everybody all at once anyhow. So what do we have? We have questions here, discussion.
Hey.
Hey there.
Hi, Stephen here.
Hi, Stephen.
I have a question about the a fantastic presentation, by the way. Really.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Very, very, very clear, and a lot of light bulb moments for me here. One question about the money site. You know, not being a target site, but being part of this group. Would that then not imply that that site should, in fact, kind of link out to some other members of that group?
I would link out to other resources, but I wouldn't link out to every member of my group, but I wouldn't be afraid to link out to a member of the group either.
Right, yeah.
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 Okay. You know, especially like YouTube, I might take that YouTube video and embed it in my original post.
Of course, yeah, that's a great way to do that. Yeah.
So, absolutely. And you know, the idea here is anything that is natural that would naturally occur, it's a good idea to replicate it if you're trying to rank something.
Yeah. Yeah, but I love the analogy of the groups rather than, you know, being part of circles.
Yeah.
You know, rather than just everything coming to it. That is, that's really, really clear. Really clear.
I always forget to show this part, and probably because I haven't really selected a place to introduce it. But this website right here, internet-map.net, is actually the internet by what the tools that have scraped up websites. So you're looking at what looks like a galaxy here. But these are actually all websites, and anybody can probably guess what these two biggest circles, at least one of them, is going to be.
Google and Facebook, probably.
Yeah, and so we're going to zoom in a little bit, and there we got Google, Facebook, and YouTube. There's Yahoo.
Yeah.
There's live.com. Now, in my industry, I happen to focus on real estate, and one of the biggest sites in real estate is Zillow.com. So we're going to have a look at Zillow here. There it is. And you'll see that there's other sites that are kind of concentric around Zillow and, according to this tool, somewhat related to it. If we zoom in, we can see what they are. There's NeighborCity.com. SuperlativeStudio.com, which is a real estate website. There's WalkScore, which is related to real estate and schools. There's Foreclosure Radar. Toll Brothers is a home builder. So you see the relevance is there. And it actually starts to form a kind of little network or universe right there. And all of these things are related to real estate, MLS, Redfin, Weichert, GSMLS.com. So those are all real websites. Now what I'm going to do is zoom out a little bit. Let's compare this very dominating website in the real estate niche to the entire internet. So I'll zoom out. Zoom out a little more. I'll keep my little hand over Zillow. There's Washington Post. There's CNN. There's Huffington Post. Zoom out more. There's AOL. And there's the blue part of the universe, which is essentially the U.S. part of the internet. Now, where is Zillow? Zillow was right over here somewhere. So you can see the world of scope. You're dealing with ranking a website, and you're dealing with Google. Google is enormous. There's no point fighting this. Look at just the things that surround Google.
Yeah.
Now, you'll notice that in Google in particular, you have different colors which represent domains from different countries, okay? Each color represents a different country. The blue ones are U.S. and the other colors are China, Indonesia, and et cetera, et cetera. And so here we've got all these. There's Germany. There is – I don't even know what that is, but – you know, they tend to be from different localities, but in terms of relevance to Google, they're all clustered around Google. So we have this very dynamic nature of how websites are linked together. And that's why links are important and always will be important to Google in one respect or another, because links are how Google determines relevance and importance of websites. And so that will never go away. The way that we leverage those links and present them to the search engine will change, but the idea of links is there forever. And so that's important to remember. Other questions or comments? Everybody's unmuted.
Hey Dave, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
A little bit off the subject, because we'll do your last site you were on there. Do you remember what the name is of the company that does all the web traffic that shows the Google usage, local, the Yahoo, the Bing, and whatever? The biggest company out there that monitors all that.
Are you talking about Alexa?
No, not Alexa. I can't think about it. There was a one you could actually get a free membership to, and I had it on my previous computer, and I could actually like pull up Anaheim, California, and I could tell you the top 300 websites and what type of traffic they have. I've gone brain dead this afternoon.
Yeah, me too on that one. Don't know, buddy.
When I find it, it'll be awesome.
Anybody else have questions? If you're muted, be sure to unmute your mic before you ask your question. Yeah, Michael Holland says, Dave, are you saying that we should lay out all these connections beforehand? I'm thinking of implementation. Well, I kind of am saying, I mean, Google's going to look for them. So I don't know how you do it without laying them out ahead of time. I mean, the order I would go in would be the resource that I obviously am making the original source of content. And these particular sites here, Scoop.it, Storify, Rebel Mouse, happen to be content curation websites, bookmark kind of sites, social media sites where it's natural to talk about other websites, and often it's natural to copy a lot of their content and add a sentence or introduction or something like that. Google Plus, you know, I only brought in a few sites, but there are dozens of sites that have decent domain authority and are pretty much there for you to post whatever you want to post. And again, this isn't page rank. So we're not passing page rank. It's not based on anchor text. And we're not trying to rank anchor text. We are trying to make our site a member of a plurality of groups of resources.
Okay.
Because that is what Google looks for, to rank them.
All right, bye.
Yeah, cumulative ranking algebra does come in handy 35 years later. Yeah, this is definitely cumulative. The cumulative property of links within resources. And again, what the Panda algorithm says is not count of links to a site, rather count of links to resources in the group. So the links between the resources is just as important as the links that are pointing to your website. And, you know, the thought occurs to me, and it's probably still good advice. It's always been said, you know, don't link back to your site that your links are coming from. Don't link back from your money site to your PBNs. And that makes sense because we don't want Google to discover what we don't want them to know we're doing because it's against their terms of service and they might slam our PBNs. So we don't link back to our PBNs, right? In the natural web, it may very well likely be that you would link back to your active rain post. I also mentioned this on my active rain post, I might say, and link back to this active rain post. Or there's a little bit more about this over here on Rebel Mouse, or anything I might link out to. Naturally, where you're not concerned about ranking, you tend to link in the way that makes sense to you as somebody that's sharing content. That doesn't mean I advise you link back to your PBNs, but certainly I link back to YouTube and Facebook and stuff like that. I'm not afraid of that. It's part of my group of resources. Other comments and questions? Charlie says, Dave, are Facebook pages the same FB page? I don't make mine all the same Facebook page. I run several Facebook pages, what they call pages of their business pages. I run several of those, and then I establish some fake identities and run some stuff off of those too. Tim CV, are you still here?
Dave, can I ask you a question? It's Coco here.
Yes. Hi, Coco. How are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing great.
Listen, I wanted to take off of Charlie's remark. Was that Charlie? Yeah, I guess it was. Yes, it was. I'm trying to create a Facebook page for my SEO site, and so it's a slightly different question, but it's one that's bugging me a bit because I intended to create a new Facebook account with my own name, but just keep it separate from my personal Facebook account, which I'm with OMG with. Is that not a wise idea? And the reason being, and I'll just put it out there point blank, I had some issues with people that I didn't really even know. I just chatted with them, and then they very easily found me on Facebook, and it was not a comfortable situation, if you will. So that's my only – I'm not trying to be deceitful or hide anything. I have nothing to hide. I just don't like – mixing personal and business, and I'd rather keep people that are not part of my personal life out of it. Is that fair enough, or does it seem like I'm trying to be...
Oh, no, that's quite normal and quite fair.
Okay.
And I'll show you an example. I do both ways, you know, and it's nothing saying right or wrong or good or bad, but I chose some time back to make my Facebook personal account very public, so I set everything I could to public because I wanted to use it as an outreach for business. But right. If you look at my Facebook, for example, I don't publicize this a lot, but I'm working on my local business guide or city guide, or for me it's Orange County. So I have this Facebook page to promote it, and really all I'm doing right now is creating links, right? Inside, you know, I'm posting about things that I want part of my group of resources. So this, for example, right here, you know, this particular page, I believe has been indexed by Google. Maybe it has, maybe it hasn't yet. Not that one, but you know, Google's picking up on this page. It's public. It's not something that blasts out my name. I think you can find out that I'm the admin, but I'm not really sure. You know, but okay. I mean, if you look at the content, you figure out it's me. But this is a separate page, and
so you did create, you created it with your own name, but just not part of what
not
you
part
have connected
of my personal,
to OMG.
It's not connected to OMG. I don't necessarily run out and show this to everybody. I mean, I don't really care, but it wasn't the purpose of it. The purpose of it was to create another resource, you know, and for another group.
Good.
So here it's, and here it is being picked up by Google, you know, it's being indexed. And I've got three or four of these. Yeah, I got three or four of these under my own identity. And, you know, at some point, it's not mine. It belongs to Facebook. You know, so I try to behave myself in a way that Facebook won't come look at what I do and say, you know, we don't like any of your stuff. We're deleting your account or anything like that.
Right. Yeah.
But, you know, as an insurance, I do have a few other accounts. But, you know, here this is doing what it's supposed to do. And there are other pages. You know, I have quite a few, actually. And some I've used a lot and some I've just, like, you know, built and forgotten about. Some I administer on behalf of others. So, yeah, it's to Google, Facebook is just Facebook. It's just a website with a lot of pages in it. And some pages have links that point to other pages that form a part of a natural group that they're looking for.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. All right. Good. So then that's very good. Thank you so much. I appreciate
you're
that.
You're welcome. Glad that helped.
Hey, I can add something to that.
Who we got here? Introduce yourself. So you've got
Charlie Barks. This is Charlie Barks.
Hey, Charlie.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you. Great.
I was going to say that I had the same concern as Coco did with the privacy, and I got to checking into it, and you can, whenever you friend somebody, you can change the settings to acquaintances or block or however you want to do it, and then that controls what they can see on your page.
Yeah. I mean, and there's all kinds of settings for privacy, and any one of them is fine because you can use, you don't have to use your personal account for anything to do with business. You know, I do, but that's just some personal choice I have because, and the reason for that is because I built a brand around my name so that more people will look me up by name and that kind of thing, because that's something that Google recognizes as a brand.
Right.
Yeah. And so, you know, Mike Heffley asks, why not just use a business fan page and make your admin email, your SEO business domain from there? Wouldn't that keep you separated? I do this for another business. Seems to work fine. Yeah, it does work fine. There's nothing wrong with that at all. Total separation of your identity from what you're doing in business is great. You know, it's the right choice for a lot of people. For me, because I'm branding my name, it's the right choice for me to make my personal profile part of my resources. But that's never a necessity because Google doesn't really care whether the page is a personal profile or a business page or anything like that. In fact, Matt Cutts said they don't even use likes and you know, fans of a page and stuff like that. They don't use associations between people from Facebook to rank anything in Facebook, but they use ordinary links to rank Facebook resources because they don't want to, you know, punch through to somebody's privacy, say they don't use those signals.
But you can't like a page from a business page, can you?
Well, it doesn't matter because Google doesn't pay attention to it. That's what Matt Cutts said about a year ago.
Well, I'm just talking about using it in your business.
Yeah, no, you can't. I don't believe you can like a page unless you're liking as the individual. Yeah, again, I'm not an expert on Facebook. I'm just showing how Facebook can be used in any number of ways as part of that plurality of groups of resources. Okay.
So, Dave, I have a question for you.
Yes, sir.
If you're trying to rank or get some more eyes on a particular listing, would you do the same thing as you're doing right here to the agent page?
Yeah, I don't generally try to get eyes on a listing because you're in real estate. If I type in an address, I'm just asking a search engine to give me results for that address search. And I'm going to pick the first one I see. So if I want a website to rank for a particular page that may not have links to it quickly, the way to get that is to up the domain authority of the web page or the website so that its pages rank higher. This is why, as an example, I'm going to put my an address where I used to live here and see what happens. So 320 South Archer Street, Anaheim, California. So if I plug that in because I want to find out information on that address, I'm going to see Zillow first. And if we pull out the old Moz domain and toolbar and look at the domain authority, we see that Zillow has 95 as its domain authority, and this particular page has how many links to it? Zero, right? No links to that page. Let's look at the next runner-up, which is Trulia. They have a page from my old address, and there's the house right there in the picture. There's those two palm trees that I planted. Trulia, no links to that page. Redfin, domain authority 77, no links to that page. So how am I going to take a real estate, local real estate website that has that exact same content on it and rank it high since you've got a high domain authority already there? Well, I could do it by building links to the page and try to do something about page authority or page rank to that page and beat some of these guys. But if I really want that locality and to rank, I've got to build up domain authority enough to punch through this wall of high domain authority.
Right.
Sounds good. Right. Considering I haven't been.
Okay, any more questions?
Oh, shit.
Any more comments? Dave, your ideas blow, man. What do we got here? I think we're coming up on the one-hour mark pretty soon, and we'll probably stop it at the hour mark. Yeah, George, we can hear you, man. Yeah, I
so
figure
we're. Dave, are you taking into account any DAS?
You know, before I started recording, I made it clear that I'm staying away from, you know, covering territory on domain authority stacking. I will say that what I've just covered, there's a lot of overlap. There's a whole lot of overlap. But I'm looking at this strictly through the idea of matching what Panda wants to see. And I don't think anybody else has really presented this in this way.
Yeah.
And I've read through that Panda algorithm probably about 50 times now. So I soak it in a little more each time. It's like, well, what would Panda want to see? That's what I'm going to try to create, is what Panda wants to see. It also influences how I balance my links. If I want bookmarks or PBN links or Web 2.0 links or anything like that, I'm going to think about what would be natural for a website like this and what would Panda look for as a natural plurality of resources. You'll remember that one of the things Panda does, it has a group-specific modification factor. So every group has a modification factor that is specifically applicable to that group. So they've got categories of things on the internet that they modify in certain ways. And you'll see this where, you know, when they hit something or they don't like something, you know, for a year or so, you could not get a 7-pack listing for an SEO business. You could not do it. And then back when Google made the adjustment, All of a sudden, all these SEO businesses started showing up in seven packs, and they took it away from real estate agents. And now you can almost never get a seven pack listing for a real estate agent. Instead, Google says, we've got a brand for that. Here's Zillow. They got a list of real estate agents that you can look at. And so, you know, the group of resources is going to have a different modification factor depending on the topic, which is why it's really hard to rank some things with a YouTube video and not so hard for other things, because you're in a different specific group that Google is treating the modification differently. See, everything that I know about SEO is very well and easily explained by this one patent abstract on the Panda algorithm. It's very clear, to me at least, what Google is looking for. I will put the replay of this up on my website and share it with you guys.
Thank you very much, Dave. That was really enlightening.
Hi, Dave.
Yes.
Hi. Can I ask the last question before you close? I something like the diagram you showed us before is about the Is it the abstract or the absolute where you often go to build the popularity of resources for your website or your customer website? Can I just copy it and do it the same?
You can, but then I would not make the second batch the same as the first batch. One of the things that Google does not want to see is patterns that are identical. And again, if you look at this, here's the real internet. Okay, and this real internet has chaos. Look at ask.com, you know, like these sites here, the green ones, like rediff.com, they're from India. No, I've lost ask, but okay, here's ask. So look at the sites around ask, you know, they're not the same as the sites around GoDaddy. They're not the same kind of sites. There's obviously a grouping of sites around each of these big sites that there's a relevance between sites, but networks or plural or groups of resources are never exactly the same. It's like snowflakes. Everyone is different. Every group, every network, every connection pattern between sites on the internet is actually different. So if I go and I create group one, group two, group three, group four, group five, group, and they all look exactly the same, that's clones, that's unnatural. Yep. That's putting me at risk. So if I'm trying to please the Panda algorithm, I will try to be as near what Panda algorithm is looking for as possible. So I will not make all my groups the same. You'll see here, I made them all different. My plurality of groups of resources is marked by differentiation.
Yep.
Other question that I got here in comments was, how closely are all the sites in your universe tied together thematically? Very closely. Most of my business is about real estate. Some of my clients are assisted living, which has to do with places you live, which has to do with real estate. And so thematically, if we're talking about my resources, the content is going to be about real estate, homes, communities, living, lifestyle, you know, to do with how people live in various, all that. It's going to be closely related in its theme. And that gives me a lot of punch in the real estate niche. I did some SEO for a chiropractor site as a favor for a business partner, and they were having difficulty with this site, so I went and did that with my resources, and it was easy. You know, it wasn't as closely related, although I suppose, you know, healthcare and real estate, you know, could be considered loosely related, and it worked great, you know, because I presented the best thing that Google had to choose from.
So can I just to to re-clarify one thing. As long as I put the HiGit domain authority HiGit from the target, so it's the only rule for building the resources like that, right? Is anything else I missed from your presentation? Because I came a little bit late. I'm sorry about that.
You know, as far as I'm concerned, there's no hard, fast rule. The rule is chaos. The rule is be natural. The rule is make your resources flow between each other, just like the real internet, because that's what Google's looking for, is the real internet.
Yeah. I got your point. Thank you so much, Dave. Thanks.
You're welcome. All right. We'll just wait a couple more minutes here. If we don't have any more questions, we might be wrapping up. If we do have questions, just like they say at the wedding, speak now or forever hold your peace. Website themes are important, Charlie. And I, you know, like I said with the chiropractor, I broke out of the theme a little bit and it worked fine because that was really an easy target. But generally, my website themes are about real estate. That's if I had a website for, say, a shoe store or something like that, and then I also had real estate, I probably want to build separate resources for that shoe store that are about running and shoes and hiking and camping, you know, campsites and stuff like that, national parks, sports, and a lot less about real estate. So if I were trying to rank Franklin, Tennessee chiropractor, would a site about Franklin, Tennessee history be related? Well, I don't know. It could be. I mean, chiropractic itself has a history that I've written about chiropractors before for other chiropractic sites. And I like to tap into the history of chiropractic because it's kind of embedded with American history that at one point chiropractors were illegal. They were charged with practicing medicine without a license, and the whole gamut of conflict between traditional MDs and chiropractic doctors. So history is always fun to tie into that. But a website about Franklin, Tennessee's history, I don't know. I mean, here's the thing. It's about Franklin. And so there's relevance there. And again, I would try to build more resources that are more closely tied. One website about history, sure, why not? You know, it would make sense for a site about history to say, here's what's there today, a chiropractic business, where before they had the town doctor who was really a quack, and now they don't have a quack. They have a chiropractor and a doctor who refer to each other. I mean, there's ways to make things fit.
Oh, see.
Does it matter if the content in the blog is not unique? Now, if it's your PBN, I'd say make it unique. Certainly, if it's your money site, I'd say unique. But let's take an example. Let's get up my own Storify here. And the beauty of these things is a lot of it's so public, I don't worry about it very much as far as you know, what if somebody sees my link? I don't care. It's Storify. It's just something linking to a resource. So here's Storify. And what have I got here? Are real estate agent websites part of Eric? And so you got to click the story to see the rest of it. So I'll click the story. And so the question is, are real estate agent websites part of Eric Schmidt's cesspool? Google has seemed to take an even more dim view of local agents, giving them even less visibility in 2014. Now, here I have linked to my money site where I have a blog post. Okay. This is my only original sentence, is this one right here, and the title is original. The rest of this I copied straight from my website, hacked it right out, okay? Because this is a content curation website, and that's what naturally occurs on this kind of website, okay? And I embedded a YouTube video from my YouTube channel into this post, all right? And here is the SEO article, and you notice I use keywords that are not very specific. the SEO article is my anchor text in case it gets picked up by anything else and converted into dofollow. I think this is nofollow. And here's the link to it again, just as the source. Now, this Storify, I will take another resource like Rebel Mouse, and I'll link to this Storify and add one original sentence to the Storify and then pick up this content and put it in, not Storify, I'm sorry, Rebel Mouse or Scoop It, you know. So I'll take another curation site and mostly borrow this content and add a couple of observation sentences, and there you go, because I'm not trying to rank these. These are already authority resources. This is a DA91. So I'm creating the links between these resources, and my website happens to be cited within these resources. It's really just a member of the group. Is this recorded? Yes, it's recorded. I'll put it on my website. All right, guys, I think we're down to the wire and the questions have stopped, so I am going to conclude this session. We're going to take one more question here. Does this make ranking a city guide site more complex? This is more complex. Yes, of course, it's complex because you're dealing with what's on the left versus what's on the right. What's on the right is simple. It's easy. It's quick. It's easily detected, and it will be outranked by what's on the left, which is obviously more complex. Now, here's the thing. Sometimes what's on the right is all there is, and Google will rank the site in the target in the middle because links are the life juice of the internet for Google to rank things. And so if they got nothing else, they'll rank with this. But as soon as this is introduced on the left, that is going to be picked up by the Panda algorithm and used in lieu of standard page rank and links. So is it more complex? Well, yeah, this is more complex than this. You know, yes, it's more complex. That's the nature of the web. If you want to rank, you got to go the way Google wants.
Thanks, Dave.
You're sure welcome. All right, guys, we're going to close this out. I'll put up a notice when I get the recording updated. So this is Dave Keys signing off. Thanks for attending, everybody.